It never really occurred to me, and this is my own naivete, that I would ever be anything other than a professor. It just, you know, I interviewed at some pharmaceutical companies, and it was nice, and I liked it, and they were smart people. But I said, no, I want to do my research. I want to teach. At the time, Emory was a small regional university with a couple of spots of excellence. But by and large, it was considered a sleepy kind of environment, which all changed in 1978 when Robert Woodruff donated over $100 million to Emory, and Emory started to get into high gear to bring itself up to where we are now. For a long time, I think people in the virology field generally considered me to be one of the most creative synthetic chemists who was working on antivirals. A lot of the chemistry was very classical, somewhat mundane, and we developed a lot of new methods for making compounds that were completely novel, because that was my training. That's what I, so it was like a candy store. I could think of ideas, we could try them. People would say, wow, that's a really good idea for making that. That's much more efficient than what we've been doing. And so it gave me an interesting stature that people said, well, he's not the world's greatest virologist. That was fine, but you know, I wasn't a cutting-edge virologist, because I certainly wasn't trained there, but I knew what I was doing. But when it came to making the compounds that we really needed to make, then I was the guy. And as I like to remind my my biologist friends, you don't sell a concept. You sell little pills that get put in a vial. All right? I'm the guy who makes the stuff that goes in the little pills. All right? So I'm an integral part of this team, and it made me feel very good to know that when I started back in the 80s and said, I gotta figure out something that I can do to make a difference, I really did. So in the mid 80s, the magnitude of the AIDS crisis really started to hit home. We saw some of our most creative people taken away from us by this terrible disease. And I just became increasingly convinced that I had to do something. So even though I didn't know anything about virology, I just felt like I had to do something. So that was my driving force for getting into it, and I never looked back. Emtricitabine, Emtriva, was important because it not only had the good potency, the good safety profile that we looked for, but it was really important because it paired up well with other drugs. And because of that pairing, we were able to take AIDS from a death sentence to a manageable chronic disease. I have a friend, a very close personal friend, who's HIV positive, and he's been on one of our drugs for as long as I've known him. At one point, he found out that he had contracted hepatitis C, as well as HIV. So if HIV isn't bad enough, to have Hep C on top of that was a huge problem. And when the Pharmacet drug Sovaldi came out, and you know, Raymond Schinazi and I were the founders of Pharmacet. And when that Pharmacet drug became available for treating patients with hep C, it was a game changer. And he took the drug for 12 weeks, was cured. Still has HIV because we don't have a cure for HIV. But it's nice when you go to a restaurant and you meet someone out of the blue who tells you these things, and it's something completely different when a close personal friend is flourishing. I can't tell you how much personal satisfaction I get from things like that. I gave a talk at a university, and a woman in the back raised her hand immediately and said, Dr. Liotta, I don't actually have a question. I just wanted to say thank you because my son is HIV positive, and because of your drug, he is really doing well. People burst into applause. And my response was, thank you so much. But thousands of dedicated scientists had their fingers on this development process, their fingerprints on this development process. And when you're being thankful, let's thank them all.